We'll now look at how to use fminsearch to do multivariate minimization, so a function of more than one variable. In this case, the setup is going to be the same way, but let's look at a function described as 4x squared plus 6 times quantity y minus 1 squared plus 4 times x times y. So it's a nonlinear function that we're looking at, and we want to find the global minimum of this function. So first, we need to define our functions. So let me first make sure everything is cleared here. Alright, so we're ready to go. So I want to define my function first. Now I'm going to start by defining it in a way that if we were not using fminsearch would be okay, but then we're going to see how fminsearch can't actually work on it, and we'll see how we can redefine it. So I'm going to call this f1 just for demonstration purposes. So again, this is a function of two variables. So the way it's written on the slide, it's a function of x and a function of y. Okay, so it's going to be 4 times x quantity squared, and I'll set this up to work with vectors, plus 6 times the quantity y minus 1 squared, plus 4 times x times y. Again, potentially this could have vectors with it. Okay, so we have our definition of f, y called f1. And it takes two arguments, the first being x and the first being y. And we see that the way I use it here, it doesn't work if I only give it one argument because it's expecting two. All right, so the function works. I'm not going to plot it now because at the moment we don't know. It's a little bit tricky to plot. We'll get into that in a couple of weeks. I will plot this at the end just to show you quickly, graphically, that our answer is going to match up pretty well. Again, this is the function we're trying to minimize. So we can set up similar to how we did before. We want to use fminsearch. Now, kind of naively, we might think, oh, well, I want to change the values of x and y of this function f1. That's a function, again, of x and y. And then here, this is what, when I do it the correct way, we're going to see this again. But we have to give it an initial guess for every component or every element that the function takes. In this case, since there's an x and a y value, my initial guess has to be a vector of two elements. Just for simplicity, I'll say 0 and 0 as my guess. And we'll see what happens if I try to run this. Let me put a comma between here, although it is optional. If I rerun this cell, it doesn't like this. It thinks there's not enough input arguments. And the reason is that even though fminsearch does work on multivariable functions, we have to have our input be a vector, not two scalars. Or if there were three variables it was a function of, then it would have to take a vector of three elements. It can't take three scalar variables. I'll demonstrate now what that means. So instead of writing f1 like this in terms of x and y, I still need it to be a function of two variables, but I have to write those two variables as a function. I'll make this a different function, in which case I'll call just f. Alright, so it's going to be a function only of x, but here x is going to be a vector that has two elements in it. Alright, so it's going to be 4 times what I used to call x, I'm going to call x of 1. Alright, so it's the first element of what I'm calling x is going to be squared, plus 6 times, instead of y, that's going to be the second element of x, minus 1, quantity squared, plus 4 times x is going to be what I'm calling x1, dot times y is what I'm calling x2. And it helps here to have probably a comment that x is x1, y is x2. So we remember this is what we call a mapping. I'm referring to x as x of 1 and y as x of 2. And we can verify that we're going to get the same results here. Again, going back to, let me clear the screen and let me run this again. And it didn't like something here. Let me take a... Okay, it's because it's trying to run this function. I'm going to comment this out for the moment. To quickly comment a whole line, you can push Control-R which makes it a comment, and to undo it or to uncomment, Control T will uncomment an entire line. All right, so since that didn't work, I'm only running these first two. I'm defining F1 and F. So the way I used F2, it took two scalar arguments and gave me one, the value of my function, in this case 38. To use F, it also takes two elements, but here I can't use it the same way I used F1, because it's not expecting two different arguments, it's expecting one argument that's a vector. So in this case, it wants to use it the same way, the vector 2, 2. And we see we get the same number, we get 38 again. And just to demonstrate this works, if I put a different pair of numbers in F1, I give it two scalar arguments, and it gives me that value. However, for how I defined F, I have to give it one vector argument, and I get the same result. The latter way, the way that F is defined, I can use this with fminsearch. So let me modify how fminsearch is being defined. So F1 did not work, however, F will. So again, it takes one vector input, and now this should work for me. I have to give it my initial guess. In this case, because there is a vector as my input, I have to give it the initial values for those two inputs. So let me change this just for demonstration purposes. My initial guess is that this function is minimized when x is equal to 1 and y is equal to 2. So I have the vector 1, 2 as this second argument here. And if I run this, I get my xs min and I get f min. So look at these two outputs I got. This is the x value and the y value that minimized my function. And then f min, this is the value of the function when it was minimized. If I change my initial guess here, let's say 0, 0, and rerun this, I get the same result for this. Now, I don't have a graphical output yet to know, is this a local max or a global max, sorry, a local minimum or a global minimum, but we do see that if we, even as we kind of drastically change these guesses, I keep getting the same result. So at least, even if this is a local minimum, there doesn't seem to be another minimum near it. I'm going to suppress this, so I have my values in here for fmin still, and xsmin. Again, the x and the y coordinates, where that minimum occurred. Now, just so we can see graphically how this matches up, this is more complicated a function than we've graphed previously, because it is a three-dimensional, or it's a function of two variables, not just a function of one variable. So we'll get into the details of this a little bit later, but I do want to just demonstrate that we can visualize this in MATLAB. All right, so let's look at, I'll go negative 20 to 20. Now, again, we're going to be covering this later, but I'll at least show it now. I can use the mesh grid command, which I'll get to in a bit. And I can use this information to actually make a mesh plot, as we'll see. If I take my x values, my y values, and then f1, so my original function that was defined as two scalar inputs, and I can run this. Let me clean this up a little bit, add a couple of labels so that we can identify which variable is which. So I have an x label, I have a y label, and now I have a z label. That's going to be my function f. All right, and we see that using mesh, we get this nice, interesting surface here where we can see as x and y change, how does the value of our function change? And I'll make this even bigger here so we can see it. All right, so we can see it makes this kind of bowl shape, and then the bottom of that bowl is where the function value is going to be minimized. So let me actually change this slightly to mesh C. And we can see we get not only this mesh plot, but we get what's called a contour plot on the bottom that helps us visualize how the value of C is changing, the value of F is changing. So the center value down here, this is where that minimum is going to occur. And let's see how this lines up to what we predicted before using fminsearch. So we said that the minimum should occur when x is negative 0.6 and y is positive 1.2. It's a little bit tough to see in 3D, but we can actually maybe change the viewpoint. That doesn't help too much. Get back to our original view. I'll line it up a little bit better here. All right, so we see what's happening here, that this dot, which looks like it's the bottom of the bowl, that's where the f value is going to be minimized. If we go according to this axis system, a little bit in the positive y direction, so this should correspond to 1.2. And in the x direction, let me line that up, we see that here is where x is equal to 0. If we go a little bit to the left of that, specifically 0.6 to the left, so we're at negative 0.6, that's where the zero, that's where the minimum value of this bowl shape is occurring. We can get a little bit more detail. Let me put the grid on for this. But we can rotate around, and we can, once we learn some of these more advanced functions in a couple of lectures here, we can just verify that fminsearch did indeed find the global minimum of this bowl-shaped function to be at, again, I'll reiterate, that we found it to be negative 0.6 in the x direction, 1.2 in the y direction, and the actual function value where it's of its minimum was negative 1.2. To recap this problem again, our function took two inputs. On the slide they were called x and y, but in order to use fminsearch, I had to express it like I do on line 139 here, where I call x of 1, or the first element of a vector x, and x2 corresponds to y, and that's the second value in a vector x. The notation here is a little bit confusing. The way I'm using x in 139 is it's a two-element vector. Again, I'm mapping what I was originally calling x to the first element in the vector, and what I originally called y to the second element in that vector. So once it's defined like this, where my input is a vector, I can take that into fminsearch, and it is able to do a search in this case, two dimensions. I give it some initial guess, and it gave me out the x-coordinate and the y-coordinate of the minimum value.